Welcome to Experience Life. I'm Reuben Egolf. Good to be with you here today on this Sunday morning. I pray it's a bright Sunday morning, whether it's raining or not, in your house. And I know God's Spirit is always bright and full of glory. And I'm glad that you tuned in today. God has a special message for you today in simply dealing with a new beginning. So if you're looking to make a new beginning, you've tuned in at the right time. So God has put you there for a reason. So we're going to get on board and start afresh here in today's program. But before I get to that, I want to make a special announcement because it's just around the corner on July the 7th. That is on a Sunday, July the 7th on a Sunday, Sunday night to be precise, at 7 o'clock. I have been invited to speak, and I count it such an honor and a privilege. I was there a few years ago, and we had such a wonderful time. I look forward to going back, but I'm doing the Vesper service at the Franklin County Fair. Now, that's located at the Chambersburg Rod and Gun Club on the Warm Spring Road. If some of you are familiar with that, you know where it is outside of Chambersburg. It's at 7 o'clock. I want to invite you, if you have the opportunity that night from wherever you might be coming from, to be there that night at 7 o'clock. I'm looking forward to it because I feel that God has laid on my heart a special message similar to what I've ministered here in the church, similar to what I've shared with you as the television audience some time ago, and I believe it's going to be a special message to America, dealing with some of the things that we're dealing with in America in a backslidden condition and a lack of the spiritual nature of God being a part of our government today and a lot of society. And I really feel strongly about this, and I'd really love for you to be there, not just for your support, in other words, but I believe it's something God is going to impart because it's not going to be televised. We're not going to have the cameras there, so it's whatever happens there, you're going to have to take home with you, okay? And so keep that in your calendars just around the corner, July the 7th. 7 o'clock, Vesper service, kicking off the Franklin County Fair. You see, Franklin County where? I know this is in four states. That is in Pennsylvania. It is taking in Greencastle, Mercersburg, Waynesboro, Chambersburg areas, that county. And that's where it is, not far outside of Chambersburg. Really, it's not even that far outside of Greencastle to the fairgrounds, okay? Also, I want to make an announcement and keep you up to date that we are also on radio. Experience Life Today is on radio. It is on the AM dial, 1240 AM. 1240 AM on the dial of AM. So there on Sunday morning as well, just prior to you watching this, 8:45 to 9 a.m. 8:45 a.m. to 9 a.m. I know it's only 15 minutes, and just before this television program comes on. It is in the Hagerstown area, but it does branch out. Some of Pennsylvania gets it. It gets all around Hagerstown, Boonesboro, Smithsburg. All of those areas can get 1240 AM. It is not what you're hearing on here. It is not from the television. It is not from Mount Calvary Tabernacle's messages. It is actually being done privately. My father records it. I do it here in the sanctuary, but it is it's its own teaching. And so for about, actually to be exact, about 14 minutes of it, we actually teach on subjects that I have tackled here, and we do series. So if you get on board, we may run 3, 4, 5 weeks on a series of what a topic may be, and each week. And you don't get lost. We kind of rehash what was done last week and just bring you up to speed. So just to let you know, there's a lot of options, and you can also get on the websites and past videos, current videos, current television programs on exblife.org. Sends you right over to YouTube. All of it in its entirety. You don't have to miss a thing. And so you go on the Mount Calvary website. On there is a lot of audio, and so a lot of things on there, books and materials. And my goodness, I'm rambling on here today, but we appreciate your prayer requests. People are sending in prayer requests, and we pray for them, and we also want to know the testimonies. Share them back with us. Keep us abreast of what's going on, and we'll continue praying and shouldering the prayerful responsibility with you, okay? So stay on board, and remember also the products that we have on there, all on there for your convenience. You can shop around and see what you might like and try, and I believe it'll be a blessing, whether it's CDs or the books that have written, and et cetera. And those of you who monthly support us, I can't say thank you enough. I know many of you, not some, many of you, it is very sacrificial. And I want you to know it's not taken for granted. Every time those checks come in, I want to tell you, we appreciate it. We are thankful that you take the time and sacrifice to keep this television program on the air and to be a blessing. Okay? So God bless you for it. All right, let's get right into this. A new beginning. I believe you're going to be glad you watched this message today, and I give God all the praise. So come on, let's experience life today. Chapter 20, I'm going to revert back to Wednesday night. I'd love for you to have it, especially you that are young in the Lord about tithing. I would love for you to have Wednesday night. And it is a different approach, and I am going to be returning to Genesis 2. I'm not necessarily talking about tithing this morning, but deal with the concept that I did on Wednesday night. In 2 Samuel chapter 20, and I didn't bring a blanket. Does anybody have a blanket that I can use? Is there any blanket in the building? Is there one? Just bring me one, I guess. And I'm just going to show you something here in just a moment. Thank you. Can you see to get up here? Is it all right? All right. Okay. I'm looking for a fight this morning. Can you tell them? You can tell them. All right. Having a new beginning. 2 Samuel chapter 20. And I want you to look over at verse 10. And we're going to read verse 10 through 13. But Amasa took no heed to the sword that was in Joab's hand. Don't worry, we'll deal with the history in just a moment. So he smote him there in the fifth rib and shed out his bowels to the ground and struck him not again. And he died. So Joab and Abishai, his brother, pursued after Sheba, the son of Bichri. And one of Joab's men stood by him and said, "He that favoreth Joab and he that is for David, let him go after Joab." And Amasa wallowed in blood in the midst of the highway. And when the man saw that all the people stood still, he removed Amasa out of the highway into the field and cast a cloth upon him when he saw that everyone that came by him stood still. When he was removed out of the highway, all the people went on after Joab to pursue after Sheba, the son of Bichri. You say, what is happening here in this story? And you say, having a new beginning. And that's where we're going to start and head on down this direction. In this particular story, in chapter 20, you're dealing with really the third division of Israel and rebellion. You have a man here in the beginning of the chapter. His name is Sheba. This man is causing a rebellion. He is causing a split in Israel and does not want to come under the rule of King David. As a result, let me even take you behind this even. You have Joab, you have Abishai, you have Sheba, and you have these people that are involved here, okay? Now, what happens is in Amasa, and I got to tie all of this together and it takes just a little bit, so just bear with me. King David, prior to this, has already dealt with the second in rebellion, which is his own son, Absalom. Absalom has led a coup in Jerusalem and has actually deported David out. This is prior to this. David then puts out the order to capture his son, but do not kill him. You know that Joab does not listen to that, and when he finds him hanging in the tree, Joab has him killed and stabs him and kills him right there. As a result of that, King David removes Joab out of being the commander of his military or his host, okay? As a result, this gets kind of odd. Amasa is the commander of Absalom's army, okay? This is very odd, but this is what happens. Amasa is the commander of his opponent, his own son's coup and military. He puts Amasa in charge of his military, actually unseats Joab and sets him aside. Joab does not take this in a kind way. He seethes about it.
Then what happens is David, in this next rebellion, Sheba says, we are not coming under David's rule, and we are not believing that God is only dealing with him. We are going our own separate way. And he goes to Gibeah, and he leads other people with him in this faction. David says we need to squelch this rebellion fast and as quickly as possible. Joab is out, Amasa is in. But the problem is with Amasa, he moves too slow to mobilize the army to go after him. And it makes King David mad, and so he unseats Amasa in the middle of it. And you might guess, well, why is Amasa moving slow? Because his allegiance to David probably would be in question to begin with. So I don't know why David would have put him in charge, but that's the way it is. He unseats Amasa and replaces him with Abishai. Abishai is the brother of Joab. Now, Abishai leads the military out and heads towards Gibeah, and they're heading towards Sheba. The problem is, you have Amasa shows up in the middle of the march, and he takes his place with the captains and the military leaders. When he does, Joab shows up on the scene, and Joab does not want anybody taking his authority. He is that kind of an individual. He's not one to be trusted. And when he comes, here comes Amasa, and he walks up to Amasa. Joab takes him by the beard. This was a common custom, pulls him towards him, and then whispers basically, you know, how are you? How are you doing? You doing all right? And Amasa does not suspect that Joab has this sword with him, or this dagger. And when he does, he pulls him close at the same time, as disgusting it might be, he stabs him in the guts and literally draws out his bowels right on the highway in front of this army. And this military people are all standing around. When it happens, he falls to the ground, he wallows in his own blood, and instead of marching on, everybody comes to a standstill. And as a result of the standstill, they are supposed to be going on down the road. And Joab says, now let's move on and let's get started down the road to success. And let's take over Sheba and down to Gibeah. Let's really take over and do what needs to be done and get Israel back to a new place and a new beginning under a new king. And let's really get the job done. The problem is that in the middle of the highway here, if I just put this, in the middle of the highway, they can't move because there's a bloody mess right in front of their eyes. As a result of that, you know that in your own life, every now and then, unexpected things happen or whatever the case, it can turn out to be a bloody mess or something you weren't realizing, and people then stop at that place, and when they do, all they do is stare at the problem, and that consumes their mind, and they can't move beyond this little happening that might have took place even 10 years ago, 20 years ago, whatever the case, and everybody is just staring at the problem. How many knows the word rubbernecking? Does anybody know what I'm talking about? Truck drivers know about rubbernecking. How about it, Brother Bob? Rubbernecking is, you see, you're going down the highway and traffic is backed up, and I mean, it's backed up for 2 miles on your side of the road, and when you get to the accident, it's not on your side, it's on the other side, and then turn out it might only be a fender bender, but everybody's going down the road and they're not looking ahead. They're looking over at somebody's mess. Are you following me so far? And so they're, and it stops progress. You say, well, what happens here? What's going to happen? What is going to move this military on to continue down the highway of life? And I'm going to tell you something. What's going to move you or me down the highway in our own lives is that something has to be dealt with right in the middle of the road. Okay? Now listen to what happens. One of the men with Joab sees that we've got a problem. Everybody is staring at the problem here. Everybody is staring at the mess that's in the middle of the highway. What does the man do? The man picks up the body and takes it off the highway and lays it over towards the weeds, so to speak. All right? Now notice what else he does. He doesn't just take it over there and lay it. Why? Because people will still see it. Are you still with me? What else does he do? He takes a covering, takes something over, and he covers it up. I know this ain't as good as it should be, but he covers it up so you can't see it any longer. And that then what happens? They move on down the highway to a new beginning of military success and establishing the kingdom under David. Now you say, what does that apply to me? There are things in our lives, there are times you've got to get the thing out of the highway and get it covered by the blood, so you can move on down the road. Are you hearing what I'm saying this morning? Just to preempt this, there are things in our lives that are stopping progress, and sometimes you got to move it out of the way and cover it in the blood, forget about it, and walk on. And when somebody reminds you about it, tell them where it is. It is underneath the blood. Amen? All right, now, I want to share some other things with you here this morning, and I want to get started. Look at Genesis chapter 2 now. Genesis chapter 2 and verses 15 through 17. It is where we were on Wednesday night, but I want to show you some things on how to have a new beginning. Number one, we just learned, sometimes you got to get things out of the highway. Get things out of your road and get it under the blood so you can move on down the highway. In Genesis chapter 2, I'm going to show you another way, an understanding on how to have a fresh start. In verses 15 through 17, are you there? Amen. Ready? Read with me. And the Lord God took the man and put him into the Garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat of it, for in the day that thou eatest thereof thou shalt surely die. Now, I'm going to be redundant, but many of you may not have been here Wednesday night, and this is for you as well. All God is saying is this: you can have all of the trees in this garden. You can have this entire forest. You can have everything that is here, but you can't have this one tree. Why? This is my tree. I'm quarantining this tree off. It is off limits to you. And you may say, well, was the fruit bad? No, there was nothing inherently wrong with that tree. Honestly, God does not create evil. Am I right? God didn't create some sort of a bad fruit on that tree that was going to do something. It was not the fruit that brought the downfall of man. It was the disobedience to God's word. It wasn't the apple that we say. We don't even know what it was. It wasn't the orange or the apple or any fruit. No, it was the act of disobedience by infringing on what God had set apart for himself. And when God sets something apart for himself, he doesn't want us intruding into his place that he set off for him. Amen? You say, why is that? There's all of these trees out here, and he can't eat this one. This simply is mine. Leave it there. Now, why? Because God leaves us with choices for what reason? God leaves us with choices because choices prove love. Can you say amen? Choices prove love. What do you mean by that? I used it on Wednesday night, and I'll just pick them out, okay? when you look at Mike and Melinda here, okay? Now, here is, you have this married couple right here, okay? Now, how can we do this? How do we do it on Wednesday night? He meets her, and he says to her, you know what? I don't know what he calls her, Mindy. Melinda. You know what? I choose you. I choose you. I'm telling you, I choose you to marry you. I choose you to spend the rest of my life with you. And you'd say, well, how's it going to make her feel? Well, let me change the scenario. What if she was the only other woman on the planet? Okay? Now think about this. Nobody else, only him and her are existing. She's the only other woman on the planet. Do you think him choosing her would mean a whole lot to her? You know why? Because there's no other choice, okay? Now, what if he comes to her now and says, let's do it again. He says, girl, I choose you, and now there are 3 billion other women on the planet. And he says, I choose you to marry you and spend the rest of my life with you. Now, does it change on how she feels about his choice? Do you know what that choice did? It proved his love, right? Why does God in Genesis chapter 3 say that? Why does he put a choice? He did not create Adam as a robot. He created Adam with the freedom of choice that he could choose to love God or not to love God. And the only way to find that out is put choices and create choices in his life and let him choose on his own, and by his choices it will determine who or what he loves. So if he chose not to eat of the forbidden tree, then it proved that he loved God. The problem was he became very weak in the temptation and would not protect what was his, and he gave in to the god of self, and he chose to love himself instead of choosing to love God. Love is just that. It is a choice. Are you with me? So am I losing anybody? Are you all right? And so when you see these choices, even in Genesis 2, when you see that, that's why you can preach tithing from it and not infringing on the things that God has set out. That 10%, that's God's. And if you get into that, you put yourself out of the blessed place. You know, what do you mean by that? Because in the Garden of Eden, what happened? When they intruded in what was God's and his alone, that put them out of the blessed place and put them out into a place that would not cooperate with them and not work with them anymore. The soil on the outside was not going to cooperate with them. It's going to make it harder. They're going to earn by the sweat of the brow, because everything was going to become hard in doing things. It was not hard in the garden. This is the same way now. Listen, to have a great beginning with God, we have to learn that choices prove our love. And if we choose God, things will. What does the Bible say in Romans 8? All things work together for good to them who? That love God. Is that right? And so when I choose God's way, it'll cooperate with me. If I don't choose God's way, everything stops working with me and it becomes a hard, laborious life. Are you still here? Amen. Can you shout amen louder? All right. I don't preach for an amen, but I sure enjoy hearing them. All right, just thought I'd say that. All right. Now, see, God is sovereign. Let's move on here to something else. God, you hear this all the time. I wrote a book on it. God is sovereign. Yes, he is. And people say, well, all right. And here's another thing. Don't get the misnomer. Don't get the misunderstanding about that God is sovereign to this extent, and it's either he's going to do it and we have no part to play. God is sovereign in the sense of he is all powerful. Do y'all believe that? He is all powerful. He has a plan, and his plan will be achieved. But however, it's like a chess match. We, in that chess game, and it's with God, we have the freedom to make choices, to make a move. But God also chooses and makes his own move. He has a plan that he has set out for the corporate world, and he also has a plan for each of our lives as well. Do you believe that? I can choose to be on God's side by choosing what he chooses, or I can oppose him and make my own choices without consulting him. You see, if I choose to go against his choices, I do it my way. So I'm on the other side of the chess game. Every time I make a move, he makes a move. You know what he's doing? He is trying to stop us from digressing down the wrong path. So he'll put a blockage or a blockade in front of us to say, now check, stop, check. And every time we move, and this is why at times there is a lot of frustration that is dealt with in those things. God is trying to shift it away to his way of doing things, you see. Or I can go with God and choose his way, and we know it by the Bible and by the Spirit of the living God. Can somebody say amen? And so you can go on God's side or go on your own side, and it'll be eventually God's purposes will ultimately win out. Amen. Now, when we are in this life of God, let me show you something else quickly, and I'm going to get down to something where we're going to hang our nails today. But when I choose God's choices, it is what is known as walking in the Spirit. Now, when you start out in God, let me use a brand new pair of shoes. When you get saved, when you receive Christ and receive salvation, It's like putting on a new pair of shoes. Okay? You have lived your life. I've lived my life. We've lived our lives consumed with our own choice making and gratification of self and all of those things and pride and so forth and ego. Now, when we are saved, this is such a new way of living. It is like putting on a brand new pair of shoes. What happens when you put on a new brand new pair of shoes? They're stiff, right? Do they fit? Yes, they fit, but it's stiff. They fit and it feels just a little awkward and a little odd. You know when you were first saved. I know it was the same way with me. The very first time I lifted my hands in church, or the very first time I witnessed to somebody, what did I feel? Oh, I felt a little awkward. I'd never done this before. I was excited to do it. I wanted to do it, but it was different. I didn't know at first, when was I hearing the Lord or me or who or what? And so at first, it was like a stiff pair of shoes. But listen, as you continue to walk in the Spirit by obeying the Lord, do you know what happens with your shoes the longer you walk in them? Well, you give them a couple months and you're constantly walking. After a while, you don't even know they're on your feet. Why? Because your foot and the shoe have become one. Am I right? There's no resistance. There's no whatever the case. Now it's just pliable, and they're just your foot and your toes are just working together. The leathers become flexible. Well, you can take that a little far, but when the Holy Spirit, the longer you work with the Holy Spirit, the more comfortable, and the next thing you know, it becomes more natural to walk in the Spirit than not to walk in the Spirit. Am I making sense here? So don't get frustrated. Don't let the devil, he loves to condemn and bring all kinds of charges that are false and pseudo against your life. But listen, continue to make choices that God desires for you to take. And after a while, you'll make those choices without even thinking about them. Am I right? So understand that little analogy. I'm hoping I can help you out just a little bit. Now, I want you to look back now in Exodus chapter, look at chapter 2. You know that when you get to Exodus chapter 2, you're looking at a new beginning for Israel. And how to have this new beginning was the condition of the Israelites when you begin here in chapter 2. And I'll get to this, but first of all, understand the condition that they were in. They were in bondage. They were also slaves. They were in bondage to Egypt. They were slaves to Egypt. And their firstborn, when you come into this, their firstborn is going to be under the sentence of death. You see in Exodus chapter 4, when God decrees the first message here basically to Pharaoh, and when they would not let go of God's people, then you know at the end that there was going to be a sentence of death over the firstborn. So when you come through these chapters over to chapter 11, all the way from the beginning to chapter 11, you're dealing with all of these scenarios and the plagues, and at the end, the firstborn is under the sentence of death. Now listen, even Israel's children was under the sentence of death. Even they were under the sentence of death, but they had an opportunity to escape death. Can somebody say amen? And so this is the condition when you get to the end of chapter 11. This is what is going on with Israel. And now in the first 11 chapters of Exodus, look here in chapter 2, 23 through 25. You may have to read it in your Bible. I had to make it smaller because I wanted it all fit on one frame. All right, let's begin. Chapter 2, verse 23. And it came to pass in process of time that the king of Egypt died, and the children of Israel sighed by reason of the bondage, and they cried, and their cry came up unto God by reason of the bondage. And God heard their groaning, and God remembered his covenant with Abraham, with Isaac, and with Jacob. And God looked upon the children of Israel, and God had respect unto them. Isn't that a beautiful verse in verse 25? He had respect. You know, some will tell you that means he took notice to them. He also heard their cries, and he also had compassion on them. Aren't you glad God takes compassion on us even when we were in bondage? Amen? Well, I'm going to tell you something. He still has compassion on you today. Now, here he's dealing with, they witness the tender compassion of God. You say, well, they need a new beginning. They need a fresh start. They need a new start. But notice, even though they witnessed the tender compassion of God, this did not bring about a new beginning yet. Here's another thing in chapter 3, verse 10. Read with me. That's bigger on the wall. Come now, therefore, and I will send thee unto Pharaoh, that thou mayest bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. Now, notice here, they saw the appointment of a leader, Moses. Even though in Nigeria and other countries that we ministered this in, the difference between them coming in and out, they needed a leader. And that is true. But, the ultimate end of this was they still were not out of Egypt's bondage yet. Even when they saw the tender compassion of God, they saw the appointment of a leader. They also, in chapter 6, I know you can't read this, but in these verses, they listened to the divine promises of God. He promises to bring them out. He promises to rescue them. He promises to open up a way for them that seems to be no way. I will lead them out. They will come out. And I will give you a heritage. I'll give you a promised land. I'll give you a place to call your own. Even though they listened to the divine promises, they were still in bondage and they still did not have a new beginning. You see, yet not one single Israelite was delivered from bondage, even though they witnessed the tender compassion of God. They saw the appointment of a new leader. They listened to the divine promises, and they even saw the remarkable power manifested by God in miracles in the 10 plagues. And yet they still were not out of Egypt's bondage, and there still was not a brand new beginning. Now, you say, well, what are you trying to say? Well, what's going to happen? Well, I'll show you in verse 2. Look at this, chapter 12, verse 2. He said, this month shall be unto you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you. And now he begins a new calendar that when that blood is shed, this is going to be celebrated, and it's going to be the first month, and it's going to be a sign of a new beginning to your life. And I love this. In order to have a new beginning, if you're not saved in here this morning, there is a way to gain a new start, a new beginning, and a new highway. You see that he told them in chapters 12, 3 and 4, we're going a little bit deeper today and spending a little more time here, but in verses 3 and 4, he talks about a lamb that must be taken. He said, if you want a new beginning, good leaders needed. Promises are needed. Miracles are needed. Divine promises are needed. The tender compassion of God is needed. But ultimately, you've got to get to the Lamb and cross through the bloodline in order to have a new beginning. One of the problems in church today is that we are circumventing and going around the blood of Jesus Christ in order to have people gain access and a new beginning in life. We've got to deal with where it all begins. If there's no blood and there's no application, then there's no beginning in God. You see, a lamb, he says here, must be sufficient. That lamb had to meet qualifications. Aren't you glad that when Jesus came, he was qualified, because John said that basically he was without spot or blemish. Amen. Or Paul, he's without spot or blemish. He was, John said in chapter 1 of John, behold the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world. That lamb was untainted, not just physically, but he was untainted spiritually, and he was qualified to be sufficient to take care of our sins. Amen. We needed a new beginning in verses 5 and 6. The lamb without blemish, the lamb also had to be, I've written here, he had to be tested. He had to be made sure that he passed the test. He passed the qualifications. He could stand up to the testing. Well, thank God, Jesus Christ also went through the testing there in the 40 days in the wilderness, and he also went through the testing in the Garden of Gethsemane. He also went through the testing on the cross, and aren't you glad he stood the test so that we could have a new beginning? Amen. I know we were born once out of our mother's womb, but honey, if you didn't like the way you was born the first time, you can get born again. Amen. I like that. You see, and then in verse 6, last but the lamb had to be slain. The lamb had to be killed. The lamb had to shed its blood. Now, that is the first thing. A lamb must be acquired. Then the second thing I have here in verse 7 is the blood must be applied. You see, the blood provided was provided in the Lamb. The Lamb was the one providing the blood. It was in Him. Blood made available only by the sacrifice. You see, as you see in verse 7, and they shall take of the blood, strike it on the two side posts, on the upper door posts of the houses, wherein they shall eat it. Notice here, they had to personally apply the blood to their own house. Nobody else was going to do that. Not the guy down the street, not the preacher, the priest, or anybody else. Nobody was going to apply that blood. The head of that household, who was the father, was to take that blood, and he had to personally apply it. You say, what if somebody else would have came by and applied it? It would not have been recognized as being sufficient. Why? Because our salvation provides a new beginning, but we are personally responsible of applying the blood to ourselves and not somebody else. Can you say amen? You see, we cannot ride the coattails of somebody else's spirituality and expect to get to heaven or even to have a new beginning. It's good to know a Christian. It is a benefit to have a Christian praying for us. It is a benefit to be around a godly person. But ultimately, that benefit ceases when it comes to personal change and a personal reward of being in heaven. Amen? And so we want that new beginning, but it begins with the blood of the Lamb. Now, the Lamb must be appropriated. Look at this. I like this in verse 11. He'll even tell you that and thus shall ye eat it with your loins girded, your shoes on your feet, your staff in your hand, and ye shall eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover. Now, he even says that in verse 7, the time of the eating was at night. He said, I want you to eat of this tonight. You see, we had to eat after the blood was applied. After the blood was applied to the doorposts and the lintels of that home, then they remained inside and ate of that lamb. You see, they were eating behind the sheltered blood of the lamb, typifying Jesus Christ. You see, in verse 11, the attitude while eating. Why? What is the attitude why we are eating the word and feasting on the word of God? What is the attitude we should have? The attitude is simply this: we should feed upon Christ and we should eat in expectancy of His sure return. They were expecting to leave at any minute while they were eating of the Lamb, because they didn't know the hour, but it was soon approaching. There was going to come a clarion call. We're getting up, getting our belongings, and out that house we're going. We're getting in line and we're heading towards the Red Sea, and God's going to deliver us. We've got a leader. He's had compassion on us. We've got His promises to stand on. Whether that water parts or not, we're going to walk on those promises over onto the other side. God has promised to give us our own land, promised land. We're going to enjoy milk and honey. We're going to enjoy the fruit of that land. It's going to be a good thing. And when that call came, they were already ready to go. It is the same way with us as Christians. We have to be ready to go when the trumpet sounds and the voice of the archangel. We can't be there with our girdle, just our belts laying aside, loose living, loose mind. We've got to be cinched up, ready. When He says, hey, it's time to go, we're ready to go. We don't have to make any more preparation. We're all ready to walk over onto the other side. Hallelujah. You see, but it all begins with the blood of the Lamb, Jesus Christ. It doesn't start with psychology or a mental attitude. It begins with the blood, giving the Holy Spirit access to go to work with His nails and hammers of our life and begin to change us from the inside out. Let me tell you something else. It is a new beginning at the blood, but it doesn't stop there. From that day on, I've got choices I got to make every day. I've got to wear in the shoes of the Spirit. I've got to learn to live in success. I've got to learn to discern and hear the voice of the Spirit. I've got to learn. I've got to digest the Word every day. If I want to walk in victory, the blood has given me access, given me every opportunity, but I don't just ride the gravy train and think, well, I can just float on by. Every day we wake up, I've got to make another decision. Am I going to choose this or am I going to choose that? Am I going to keep God as God or am I going to exalt myself? Am I going to live under somebody's opinion or am I going to live under God's opinion? Oh, come back tonight. I'm getting into that message tonight. I can't. Hold it. Are you tired of living under other people's opinions? then you want to be here tonight. I'd left the cat out of the bag. Anyhow, the Israelites rested under the sentence of death. They had no deliverance, no hope of deliverance in themselves. Their deliverance was not about who they were. Their deliverance wasn't about whether they could walk or talk. Their deliverance was all provided in the Lamb of God. If that blood wasn't on there, they weren't leaving. If that blood wasn't on there, there was no need of a new beginning. They couldn't have it. The only deliverance is in the Lamb of God. You see, a new life or a new beginning is only found in Jesus Christ. And I want to share this with you. We celebrate Memorial Day tomorrow. We celebrate this Memorial Day of fallen heroes, and every one of them is a hero. Every one of them that gave their lives on that field of battle. We remember these men and women who gave their lives for our freedom. When you start all the way back in the 1700s, in the Revolutionary War, when you begin, when men would stand and say, you know what, I know if I'm caught, this is treason to the king, and I will have my head lopped off. When Patrick Henry stood in that common when he thundered, just filled that hall that day, and he said the famous words of give me liberty or give me death. These were not men that we have. I'll just say it. These are not the same caliber men that's down in the white place and in the Capitol, all right? These are not the same caliber as they were then. Those men had conviction. They didn't stick their finger in the wind and say, I wonder what popular opinion. They carried the burden of this nation and what God had placed upon their heart, and they weren't giving in to the ACLU, and they weren't giving in to all of the unbiblical things of abortion and homosexuality, and they said, give us liberty or give us death. We will give our lives for this, that we want liberty. I'm so thankful that Jesus, when he looked down, we have another Memorial Day called the cross. That when Jesus looked down, he knew what humanity was going to get into. He knew we were going to be in bondage. He knew, just like before the Revolutionary War, under the bondage of a king, it says you can't serve other than the Church of England. We know that. We were like that. But Jesus came and he says, look, give me liberty or give me death. He went to that cross. I'm going to shed my blood to give you a new beginning and create a whole other kingdom for you to enjoy. You don't have to stay in that old place. You don't have to stay here when you can be over here. Can somebody say amen? You don't have to stay way down here when you can be up here and have the joy of the Lord fill in your heart. Your family could be a wreck. Your home could be an upheaval. But let me tell you something. Keep looking to Jesus. And I tell you, he spoke to my heart even yesterday. Everything's going to be all right. He didn't say it, but I felt it. Calm down. I'm telling you that today. Calm down. just calm down. Everything's going to be all right. If you love God, choose him and prove it. Boy, I tell you, I felt good preaching that right there. I worked up a Pentecostal lather. Is it hot in here, or is it just all right? I'm looking at Harold's head to see if it's shining or not. I can tell. All right. You see, this is... We celebrate. This is what it's all about. You want a new beginning. You say, well, this message this morning wasn't just for sinners. This was for the Christian as well in the beginning. That's why I dealt with all those things. Our choices. Prior to that, get things out of the highway. That's obstruct. Get it out. Just move it. Cover it over in the blood. Just keep on walking. Let me tell you. Some things are going to be painful. Some things require endurance.
Our ministry, Missionaries to Asia, started from humble beginnings back in the early 1980s. The main focus was to reach the unreached in the remote regions of the Philippines. Our ministry also saw the need to establish several Bible institutes that are even right now training future ministers for the harvest fields. God has also blessed our ministry to be able to establish over 100 churches spread out throughout the Philippine Islands. My wife and I have been very active in traveling by all means necessary to share the gospel of Jesus. Yearly, our ministry holds around 7 youth camps, which are spread throughout the Philippines, in which hundreds of youth come. Many are saved and put on fire for God during those youth camps. A large percentage of our future Bible Institute students come from the leading of our Lord upon their hearts during youth camp. Also throughout the year, we hold multiple open-air evangelistic crusades in which thousands of souls come to the Lord. All glory to God. We reach out into the mountain villages, reaching the tribes and also fishing communities for Christ. Whether on the smaller islands or on a main larger island, we believe the gospel of Jesus Christ is and must always be available for every soul to hear. Our ministry has been in the Philippines for the past 30 years, and we are so blessed to have strong men and women of God that have stepped up to the plate in leadership in our Philippine branch of Missionaries to Asia. I am so excited to share with you all the vision we have to reach out into other countries, winning many more souls for Christ in other lands. Covers an area about twice the size of the state of Wyoming. Located right in the heart of Southeast Asia, its borders stretch from Myanmar to Laos to Cambodia and also to Malaysia. The people of Thailand use the phrase "land of the free" to express pride in the fact that Thailand is the only country in Southeast Asia that has never been taken over by European colonization. I believe that from the peaceful countrysides to the bustling city capital of Bangkok, Thailand, the gospel of Jesus must be preached. Thailand has a population of 67,091,089 people, of which a large percent live in Bangkok City, totaling an estimated 14,565,520 people. The religions of Thailand consist of Buddhism, claiming over 94% of the population, Islam, over 4%, and Christianity making a small trace of 0.7%, not even making a full percent of one. With that being said, and with the knowledge that we are commissioned by God to reach the lost, it is astounding to come to grips with the reality that over 66 million people in Thailand did not have Jesus as their personal Lord and Savior. And they desperately need their chance to be able to hear the life-saving gospel message of Jesus. The Word of God says in Matthew 28:19 that we are to go, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We are being led to go there and share the gospel of Jesus Christ with the people of Thailand. Our team will also consist of ministers from our Philippine ministry. With our already established contacts in Thailand, by faith we will begin this coming 2013 to reach out and establish our first church in Thailand. Afterwards, we have a great burden to establish a Bible training institute in Thailand that will train and disciple Thai nationals to become future pastors and leaders in the ministry.
Friends, I hope you enjoyed the video that you just watched. Jabez once cried out to God and said, "Oh Lord, that you would bless me indeed, and that you would enlarge my border, and that your hand would be with me, and that you would keep me from harm, that it would not pain me." And the Lord did grant his request. We are so excited that for the first time in Missionaries to Asia's 30 years of ministry, we will now be reaching out past the borders of the Philippines and reaching the nation of Thailand for Christ. We will now be reaching out to more countries within the most under-evangelized section of the world, which is called the 1040 window. We believe that in the near future, we will also be able to even reach Laos, Cambodia, and even Vietnam for Christ. Nothing is impossible with God. I would encourage you all to please join together with us in prayer. And if the Lord would lead you to support this mission in reaching the lost in Thailand, you then would be helping us to reach another soul for Christ. With over 66 million people still needing to be reached in Thailand, please greatly consider how you can help in our Lord's great commission in giving the people of Thailand the same opportunity that you and I both have in knowing our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. If you would ever want to visit us, our door is always open. God bless you and take care.
Well, I'm glad you tuned in today, and I do believe wholeheartedly that message, not a long message, maybe 37, 38 minutes or whatever, but I believe it was full of substance. I know it touched Mount Calvary here. People was touched and blessed, and at the altar time, and people starting out, getting a new beginning, starting afresh, rearranging, get things readjusted in their lives. And I pray the same for you. And also here on the heels of, you just listened to about 7 minutes of Clint Taylor and MTA, Missionaries to Asia. So appreciate this young man and his wife and Amira, their little cute daughter. They are currently, of course, many of you know, they are currently now back in Thailand. They're actually there for the first time. Philippines is where they've been all of his life. He was born basically in the Philippines, but they are in Thailand right now. He has been messaging me and keeping me abreast in Facebook and pictures. I'm telling you folks, keep praying for Brother Clint. They are having phenomenal results in that nation that is predominantly 66 out of 67 million, I think it was, is Buddhist no Christianity basically is, what was he saying, 0.03%. is actually any Protestant, affirmation. So we want to keep that in perspective. And he is having phenomenal results. People are getting saved. He said a lady came to the church one night, and she was a Buddhist, and got saved that very night. He was so excited, and we were rejoicing with him on Facebook there, and he was excited about it, of course. And so I want to share it with you because he's excited as well that we will take the time and put him on television and help them out. Anytime, go on to Missionaries to Asia. They have their own website, as he was just sharing with you in his clip. Go on to MTA, search out the website. He's keeping that abreast of everything that's going on. If you want to support them, I want to tell you something, they're good seed, or good soil. Let me put it that way. They're good soil to put seed into. You can also, if at any time you want to send to us Experience Life Today, just earmark it that way. Just say, look, I want this. Could you please send this on to Missionaries to Asia, to Clint Taylor? We will send every dime. We won't keep any of it. We'll make sure it gets to him at their P.O. box, and his mom, who takes care of all of that here in the Hagerstown, Maryland area. Okay? So keep all of that in mind. Thank you again for supporting, and thank you for your excitement about what's happening overseas. After Thailand, At the end of this year, he is returning to the Philippines. And upon returning to the Philippines, they are going to be doing some conferences. And they have invited me, yours truly, to be there next year in the early part, first week of May, I think it is, to be in the Philippines and to hold conferences, pastors, like we did in Nigeria, like we've done in Ghana, like we've done in Togo, over in Africa. And so we're looking forward to that as well. So you can be a part of that, and all of your support is appreciated. So let's let you go here today. We love you. We thank you. We're praying for you. Don't forget to send in those requests again. We want to pray for you. We want to see God do something great in your life. He does have a plan, but we've got to fulfill it in our obedience. Let me end with this. God shared this with me in prayer just the other day. He said, my blessings are my rewards for your obedience. I'll say that again. When he's talking about, I want blessed. I want the blessing of God. I need a blessing. You know, however you want to say it, we'll say those things. It's true. I need a blessing from the Lord. Well, I want to tell you something. I believe what he said to me the other day is so true, that his blessings is his rewards for obedience. And I want to tell you something. When his blessing comes on your life as a reward for obedience, you will start to see things begin to cooperate with you that did not cooperate before. It becomes a Garden of Eden spiritually around your life and as an atmosphere in your life. Amen? So you can go ahead and shout. That's the truth. It's just like in the Garden of Eden. Everything, it was God saw it and it was blessed, meaning everything was in cooperation with God, ultimately became an cooperation with Adam himself. And therefore, when he threw the seed in the ground and he tended to the garden, he didn't have any thorns, no thistles, no weeds to choke it out. Everything would grow and cooperate. There was no hindrance to the work that he was doing. In other words, he did work. Don't think that Adam was created to be a lazy bum. He was not created to be somebody just lying around sipping iced tea. He had to tend to the garden. He had to sow. He was going to reap. He was going to have to harvest. But everything was going to work with him. And therefore, labor was not quite what it is now. Now when you plant, you got to get the weeds out. You got to till it up. You got to do this and keep them out. And the thistles and the briars and all of this, it doesn't cooperate. Some soils don't want to cooperate. You have to help fertilize it. Well, in the Garden of Eden, it wasn't like that. All the soil was rich. It was fertile. It was just ready to be touched with that seed. And when that seed died in that soil, that thing just germinated and exploded out of that soil, and things became rich and was going to be a good harvest. Sad to say, you know the rest of the story, sin came in, and what happened? The blessing stopped. And when the blessing stopped, everything stopped cooperating with Adam and Eve. And when they was put out of the garden, he said, now you're going to have to do it by the sweat of your brow. It's going to be a laborious and very toilsome time throughout your life. Why? Because the blessing was now taken off, and now sin was rampant and growing. And what comes with that is a lack of cooperation. So you want the blessing of God, because when that happens, things begin to work in your favor. Things begin to come around for you, and hindrances is overcome, and things will go well. Amen? I hope that little sermonette helped you today. If you want the blessing, you've got to obey God. When you obey God, it's like turning a key in a door, unlocks the door, and out comes the blessings and the treasure trove of God, and He'll touch your life, and things will crop. Why? All things work together for good to them who love God and who are called according to His purpose.